I like you. I like your new picture.
Yeah. Okay, let me do.
You know we're recording, yeah?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's fine. They'll cut out the beginning part. Okay.
Hi, everyone.
Hi there, welcome. Glad you could join us.
No worries.
How about now, Emery? Oh, you're muted.
I think that's better.
You can hear me better now? Okay, thanks.
Still kind of soft. What do you think, Ari? Can you hear her voice okay?
Yeah, it sounds fine.
Okay, like you're twice as loud as she is, so something about your volume, but it's good enough.
Okay, and how about now? Better? Okay. Hi, Glenn.
Hello, how are you?
Good, thanks for joining us.
Of course.
Hi, Gwen.
Hi, nice to see you, Rachel. Nice to see you, Emery.
Good to see you too. Thanks for joining us.
Pleasure. Thanks for having us.
And here is Amanda. Hi, Amanda. Okay, great. We have all our presenters and now we'll wait for more employers to show up. And we're already recording, but we'll edit out this beginning part. So. Hello. Hello. think we will wait about another minute or so for more employers to show up. I'm going to give it one more minute. If you, employers, if you don't mind muting for the beginning part of our session, that would be great. All right, well, I think we're going to get started because we have our four employers here. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Carnegie Mellon University's Campus Engagement Day. My name is Rachel Rosenfeld, and I'm a career consultant in the Career and Professional Development Center. My colleague, Anne-Marie DeGeorge, is also joining us today to monitor your questions in the chat. Today's session is going to feature speakers from programs at the university that prepare students for careers in quantitative analysis and data science. Each speaker will present about their department or program, and then we'll address questions from you, the employers. During the presentation portion, please stay muted. You can put questions in the chat at any time, and we'll address them later during the Q&A. During the Q&A, Anne-Marie will be reading questions and possibly consolidating some similar ones. And given the large number of employers here, our speakers have agreed to, if necessary, to stay until 4:30 in order to answer as many questions as possible. But please feel free to leave earlier if you need to. So with all that being said, I would like to introduce today's speakers. So we have Gwen Stanzik from the MS in Data Analytics for Science program, Amanda Willard from Undergraduate Biological Sciences, Ari Lightman from the Master's Programs in Heinz College, and Glenn Kloon from Statistics and Data Science. So Gwen, you can share your screen, and if you will please go ahead and start us off.
Okay, great. Can you see my screen okay? All right. So again, my name is Gwen Stanzak. I'm the Director of Graduate Affairs in the Mellon College of Science at Carnegie Mellon. And I'm here to talk a little bit about a new program that we are offering here as a college level program in the Mellon College of Science called the MS in Data Analytics for Science program. There we go. So just quickly, you know, we'll go through the program, talk a little bit about the curriculum, and we have a capstone project that's part of it. And so I thought that might be of particular interest to this audience. And so I'll talk a little bit about the capstone project that we have and ways that you might additionally engage with our students in this program. So this is, as I mentioned, a new program. We just graduated our first small cohort of students last weekend. So we had six students that started and were really the trailblazers of this program. The program is meant to be a one-year professional degree program. And what makes it a little unique is that it really targets students in the foundational sciences, which at Carnegie Mellon is defined as mathematics, biological sciences, chemistry, and physics. The idea behind it was we wanted to provide an additional layer of skill sets to these scientists to be able to go into roles in data analytics and make a contribution in a variety of different industries. The program is offered primarily through the Mellon College of Science, so all of our faculty are teaching the courses in the program, with the exception we do have a statistics course that's taught through the Department of Statistics, excuse me, I'm tongue-tied today. And we also partner with the Pittsburgh Supercomputing Center. And so we have PhD staff that teach some of those courses as well. And our students also have the opportunity to use the supercomputing platforms in order to, they leverage the technology there in order to do a lot of their analysis and, perform their algorithms more quickly. we really want this program to be a professional program. And so, you know, part of that is to ensure students are prepared for kind of real world problems. So in addition to the courses that they're taking where they're dealing with scientific data sets in their classes, we also have a capstone project course that we hope gives the students, you know, more of an opportunity to leverage their data analytics skills in solving real world problems. We also have a communications element to the course so that students, you know, can expand their presentation and their professional communication skills. So it's really meant to try to give the students, you know, the professional skills they need to be successful. So in terms of the curriculum, as I mentioned, it's a one-year program. So students come in the fall and they take a combination of what we call mini courses or kind of half semester, 6 week courses that are kind of, you know, meant to build upon each other, as well as semester long courses. And so the first semester of the program is really designed to give those kind of fundamental math, statistics, programming, computational modeling skills that they need. And so you'll see kind of the variety of courses that they take. Our programming is mainly Python, other students are exposed to R and SQL during their time there. This is where they get their statistics course as well, so they get to choose from one of two classes as part of the options that they have in the program. In the spring then, you know, this is really when they're going to enhance their skills, start to elevate their skills as well as apply the skill sets that they're learning in their program. So again, the communications course comes into play. They're taking information visualization courses where they're learning some about Tableau and you know, some other visualization tools. They also have the opportunity to do an elective course during the semester. So this gives them the opportunity to really, you know, specialize in some way. So if they're a chemist, you know, perhaps taking a computational chemistry course. We had students do bioinformatics courses, you know, so there's a variety of different elective options that they can take in the second semester of the program. And then again, this is where they get their capstone project. So, you know, as I mentioned, the objective of the capstone is really to provide students this opportunity to enhance their professional portfolio. Many of these students are coming directly from undergrad into the graduate degree, and so this gives them a chance to get some real world experience, but also to apply the techniques they're learning in their coursework to real world data driven problems. In terms of the timeline, so at this point, you know, through the summer and early fall, we're really looking to identify projects. And so we're doing a lot of discussions with companies, you know, to try to figure out if there's a match there for some of the projects and ideas that they have. The fall is really meant to give us a chance to go through the contract process, or what we call the EPA, the Educational Product Agreement. That sometimes is the most challenging part of the process, is getting through that contract. So we give enough time for that. Usually by December, we like to have that wrapped up so that we can give the students the opportunity to learn what the options might be. The students work in teams, and so our hope is to have about 3 to 4 students working on an individual project. And so we ask the students to rank their projects, and then in early part of the spring semester, we have a faculty lead that will sort of assign the projects. You know, we try to match the students' interests with the projects and make sure we've got a good team of students working on a particular project. There is a faculty lead that will liaise with the companies. And the expectation on the company end is that, you know, you will be sort of a leader and helping guide these students. And so, you know, it may be that you have one or multiple individuals that are on a team that help to guide and shepherd the project to fruition. And so we expect there to be kind of bi-weekly or, you know, twice a month meetings with each of the teams and the industry partners. So students can ask questions, you can kind of help guide and direct them. And then there's a couple milestones along the way. We have a midterm report that they'll give, a presentation that they'll give, and then and sort of end of the semester finals and findings, and you'll get all of the collateral from the project. So obviously a lot of benefits to partnering with this. Building a recruiting pipeline is certainly one of the big benefits, but you know, it's kind of a low cost way for you to get some actionable insights, to you know, get some fresh perspective from students that are using these modern data analytics tools. And so there's a lot of benefits for us, but there's certainly a lot of benefits for the company as well. And just quickly, I wanted to just show you this year, as I said, we had 6 students that worked in teams of 2, and we had 3 projects from 2 companies. One was a pharmaceutical company and the other was a financial services. I think by the topics you can see presented here, you can tell which was which, but you know, our hope is to expand that in the coming years. We're bringing in about 17 students for this next year, and so we're hoping to get about 5 projects for the coming year. So it's a great opportunity to engage with some smart individuals. I know I'm running out of time here, and so I'll just leave you. I know we'll have some time for questions, but I'll put my email in the chat as well. And so if you have questions after the fact, you can certainly feel free to reach out to me. All right. Hopefully I stayed within my constraints, Rachel.
You did. Thank you so much, Gwen. Amanda, you're up.
All right, can everybody see that okay? Okay, yep. Great. So hi everyone, I'm Amanda Willard. I am the Director of Undergraduate Studies for the Department of Biological Sciences. And today I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about the students that we have in our department, talk a little bit about some of their interdisciplinary interests, review some of the core curriculum that our students take, and try to highlight some of the learning objectives and skill sets that I think are particularly relevant to this audience. I also wanted to spend a few seconds talking about the research experiences that our students participate in, both here at CMU as well as externally. And finally, if we have a little bit of time, I plan to show you some of the summer internships and job opportunities that our students are pursuing in the areas that you're actively looking for. While we are the Department of Biological Sciences, we offer a variety of different degree options to our students. So while the majority choose to pursue a Bachelor of Science in Biological Sciences, we also offer a major with a concentration in neuroscience, as well as a dual degree in Biological Sciences and Psychology. And we also offer a Bachelor of Science in Neuroscience, where students have the option to concentrate either in computational neuroscience, cognitive neuroscience, or neurobiology. Additionally, we do have some students that are pursuing an interdisciplinary degree in both science and arts. A lot of our students really enjoy interdisciplinary pursuits, and so they love to add on either additional majors or minors in a number of different fields. The most popular ones being biomedical engineering, computational biology, as well as computer science. And we also have some interest in statistics, environmental and sustainability studies, Hispanic studies, and ethics. The core coursework in this program involves a deep focus in biology and chemistry, but students are also getting exposure to calculus 1 and 2, physics 1 and 2, as well as computer science programming. And some of our program outcomes that I thought might be relevant to this field include using concepts, both experimental, computational, and theoretical, to apply to problem solving within the fields of science, mathematics, and technology, being able to understand and apply the scientific method, apply their knowledge towards solving problems, convey information, including scientific content in both written and oral formats, and most importantly, work in multidisciplinary and culturally diverse teams. And so just to kind of showcase the coursework that kind of covers these core foundational knowledge that we want our students to have. Being able to apply knowledge to solve problems is covered in a variety of different courses that they take. And so this modern biology course is kind of their first year introductory course. Genetics and biochemistry are courses that they take during their sophomore year here. And then cell biology and introduction to computational biology are courses that they typically explore in their junior year. And so being able to apply knowledge from each of these courses and address problem-based questions in regards to biological systems is thoroughly covered in each of these courses that they take throughout their time here. Additionally, we emphasize being able to design experimental workflows, be able to predict outcomes, as well as interpret data in each of these courses as well. And finally, being able to kind of not only analyze and interpret data, but be able to recognize trends and relationships through the graphical and statistical representation of data that covers these various fields within biology as well. And one of the great things about our biology program is the laboratory courses that our students are involved in. And they take 4 semesters of lab courses, 2 semesters of chemistry coursework that covers kind of quantitative analytical chemistry and organic chemistry synthesis and analysis. And this equates to about 5 hours of lab time a week every semester, plus a 50-minute lecture. And in these classes, they're really developing their experimental design skill sets, working on time management, as well as significant gains in written communication through the requirement of lab reports that are really encouraging them to think about their data and be able to interpret that and analyze it and put it into context. Additionally, our students take 2 semesters of intensive biology laboratory courses covering both molecular biology and biochemistry. These are even more time intensive, about 8 hours of lab time per week, plus a 50-minute lecture. And here we're even further developing their experimental design skills with a focus on analytical and reasoning skills, problem solving. And in this one, we actually go into a lot more oral communication. So in addition to the lab reports, we expect students throughout the semester to be able to present oral seminars on different scientific concepts with their peers, as well as give a final poster presentation at the end of the spring semester. And one of the interesting things about these biology labs is that about 4 weeks at the end of the semester, they're working on independent final research projects. And so this is an opportunity for students to work in teams, address a question that's of interest to them, and use the skills and tools in the lab to answer that question. And they're constantly having to problem solve on the fly and figure out, troubleshoot what's working, what's not working, and also, you know, analyze and interpret their data. Throughout their curriculum, our students get multiple exposures to relevant topics such as bioinformatics, graph plotting techniques and analysis, as well as statistics, troubleshooting, and teamwork. And in addition to all that they are involved in at the level of the biology major, as Mellon College of Science students, they also have a core education that kind of increases the breadth of their study. So in addition to the depth that they're receiving in biology and chemistry, they also have to take courses outside of their discipline and work on interdisciplinary team projects, both in their first year and junior year, and kind of further develop those teamwork, written and oral communication skills. Finally, about 85 to 90% of our students participate in research outside of the classroom, involving independent research projects, both here working under research faculty at CMU, as well as the University of Pittsburgh, Hillman Cancer Center at McGee Women's Research Institute. And in these situations, they're working on quantitative data generation, analysis, and interpretation, and they're expected to communicate their findings via written reports at the end of every semester. And then the last thing that I just wanted to show with whatever few minutes that I have remaining are some of the summer internships that our students are exploring. In addition to kind of traditional research assistantship positions where they're working in a lab and doing experimental work, they're really interested in further developing these analytical skill sets and are currently exploring even more diverse summer internship opportunities. A lot of them are continuing education through more quantitative and analytical master's programs. And many of them are going on to jobs directly after graduation in which they can kind of put these analytical skill sets to work. So I will also put my email in the chat because I know I went pretty fast. So if you have any questions, please feel free to reach out.
Thank you, Amanda. Ari, you are up.
Great. Thank you very much. Pleasure to be here. Appreciate it. My name is Ari Lightman. I'm a professor at the Heinz College at Carnegie Mellon. To give you a quick overview of the Heinz College, we're a professional program. We take two disparate disciplines, information systems and public policy and management, and smash them together. We have some very unique programs, Masters of Entertainment Industry Management, Arts Management, Business Intelligence and Data Analytics, as well as a variety of different programs associated with public policy and management. Just to give you a quick recap of who I am and why they asked me to come and chat with you folks today. As I mentioned, I'm a professor of digital media and marketing. I teach a variety of classes, but some are in the experiential learning realm where we actually bring sponsors into a class. I'll tell you a little bit about them and show you some output associated with it. I also do a lot in the executive education world. I founded two executive education programs, one for information security professionals and one for digital leaders, CDIGO and CISO programs. I also work with one of our centers that we have here at Carnegie Mellon, the Center for Machine Learning and Health. I've been with them since the inception, and we're developing a new initiative. Once again, happy to chat with you about any of these, the Center for Digital Health Innovation. On the exec ed side, I do some things open enrollment, some things closed enrollment. At the Tepper School, we've had a program with Roche for the past 6 years. I'm the faculty lead on that program as well. And in my spare time, I do some research, which is a lot of fun. I'm looking right now at two very disparate types of research, zero waste manufacturing and the cyclical economy, and everybody's favorite subject these days, non-fungible tokens, looking at management and analytics associated with NFTs. So that's me in a nutshell. I wanted to tell you a little bit about this class. As a lot of folks have mentioned already, there's a thirst for our students to really do experiential learning. We believe very heartily in the idea of RD&D, research, development, and deployment. Deployment's a tough thing because anything and everything can happen. So what happens when you deploy some of these models? Those sorts of things. So I built this class about 12 years ago. And it's a phenomenal class. We bring in 14 companies every year. This past semester, we worked with Bed Bath & Beyond, Sephora, Levi's, TaskRabbit, the Cleveland Cavaliers, YouTube, and Blizzard Entertainment. But we've done over 150 projects, 125 unique companies, listing just some of them here for you. Warner Brothers was fascinated, associated with why do people pirate their shows. At that point in time, 2012, the most pirated show was Gossip Girl. So I did have to watch a variety of seasons of Gossip Girl to understand the content, the characters, just in terms of background research associated with why people might pirate it. Other sorts of projects, we did a project for Daimler looking at understanding big data analysis. There's a variety of information that they have in the cloud associated with determining what type of driver you might be. Rachel might be much more interested in fuel economy and safety. I might be much more interested in performance. Consequently, how do you communicate to various different drivers utilizing this massive big data that we have? Netflix was a lot of fun. They actually took a look at Sense8, which was one of their fairly recent shows. They're trying to understand influence patterns, engagement patterns to make it a successful rollout. Students had to watch, they were looking at mapping to what happened with Orange is the New Black, another of their successful shows, and they watched all three seasons and binge watched it. They were very, very happy to report to the class that that was their homework and watching all three seasons of Orange is the New Black. But a lot of these projects are fascinating because we dovetail into the social space. There's so much unstructured data out there, but it's largely a mess, hence the word unstructured. So we delve in and we devise some structure to all this data. And then we combine it with other types of data stores, whether it's transactional data, viewer data, point of sales data, what have you, to create data models that our companies can utilize associated with driving innovation, engagement, and different ways of understanding product development, if you will. One of our favorite clients was HBO. We've done three projects with them. We've also done projects with Warner Media, the parent company. If you don't know who this is, it's the Night King from Game of Thrones, one of my favorite shows, but we actually did some analysis in season two and identified two distinct communities online. There was a community of folks that had read all the books and actually knew who this character was. And there was those folks that had never read the books, but were adamantly watching the show and had no idea who this guy was. So you could actually discern the two communities, do taxonomies associated with them, and understand different types of engagement patterns that HBO could utilize around bringing in consensus, actually engaging those two audiences together to create more virality associated with the show and information that they wanted to generate. In addition to working with various different companies, we also do a lot of discussions. As I'm sure you all know, social is having some very interesting ramifications to society at large. We get into that. We are a school of public policy. We're very interested in social and its impact around destruction, around societal fabric, policy-based mechanisms, misinformation online, and we take a technology spin associated with it. So each client, group that's working with a client is responsible for a discussion within class. This just happened to be a discussion on generative adversarial networks and looking at deep fakes online. All of the information that we collect, whether it's presentations for the clients or whether it's discussions, or even all my lecture notes, we provide to every single one of the clients that have come in for that semester. So this past semester, Blizzard got information not just from their team, but from everybody else who participated in the class. It's a big, large, open educational sharing network. I wanted to give you three quick examples of what we do. As I mentioned, we're applying more and more data science type projects initiatives to these sponsored projects. By the way, there's no fee associated with this class. There's no barriers to coming in. We just ask for some requirement associated with time and energy to help in terms of formulating the problem statement and working with the students over the course of the semester. And I should also mention that I pool graduate students and undergraduate students from across CMU. So yes, I do get them from Hines, but I'm also getting folks who have a master's in social work, or not social work, professional writing. We have Integrated Innovation Institute students, Tepper students, Dietrich students who do analytics and data science and those sorts of things. So this is a project that we did with W Hotels way back when, before the COVID pandemic. We used to go to hotels and stay at them. Marriott, a huge property. This is one of their brands. They were very interested in doing influencer analysis and really understanding influence at a granular level in terms of a massive conference that they did around the world. They started in LA, went to Dubai, went to Barcelona. So they were looking at influencers in different parts of the world that could spawn engagement, awareness, assessment, influence, what have you. And we created a decision tree based on all the data that we had access and privy to. So we looked at them in various different categories, fashion influencers, lifestyle influencers, and then looked at specific metrics associated with them, reported this information back to Christina, who was our contact at Marriott, absolutely flipped over it. They're actually deploying this and utilizing this within the hotels when they want to understand, assess influencers at a higher level of specificity. Another project that we did was one of my favorite toys growing up, Hot Wheels. I was very excited to work with them. So Mattel came in. This was the first project we've done. We've done subsequent projects with Mattel, but really trying to understand who is your consumer? What are they interested in? And could you identify affinity maps between different consumer groups to understand engagement patterns and how they talk and influence each other along the path. So they identified five different online market segments that were very interesting to take a look at. They did granular definitions associated with where is commonality between them associated with it. And how do you sort of engage in that specific audience? So what social channel, what metrics do you collect? How do you look at engagement patterns? All of those sorts of things, which was incredibly valuable for them. Last one I'll mention, this was a B2B play. This is Thomson Reuters. And they were very interested in understanding subject matter experts and knowledge leaders that they know of that are within their sort of stable of experts, if you will, and understanding what they talk about. So whether they talk about machine learning, whether they talk about cloud, consumer due diligence, those sorts of things, we mapped out all of that information across the board to assess and understand and make connections to them. This was just a large example of topic modeling. Right. And if you understand topic modeling, then when somebody creates some kind of mention within the social profile, what happens associated with event studies, which is just a statistical model to look at what is that event horizon before you start seeing resharing profiles and increase in mentions and those sorts of things, which is really fascinating. So that's what this is one of the classes that I created. If you're interested in it, I'd love to chat with you. Once again, I try to bring in 7 companies each semester. I'm getting more and more students interested in this kind of learning, interested in this kind of class. So I always try to find a diversity and unique new companies to come in. But this is just an example of experiential learning that we do more and more of, not only at the Heinz School, but across Carnegie Mellon. Was I under time, over time?
You're great. Okay, thank you okay. So much, Ari. And Glenn, you are up.
Hi, everyone. My name is Glenn Clune. I am an academic advisor with the Statistics and Data Science Department. We are proudly housed in Dietrich College, the Humanities and Social Science College here on campus. We've been here for quite a while. A lot of people think that we would be in like the Mellon College of Science or things like that, but our placement is actually, on purpose. we are an incredibly interdisciplinary department. You would see, data sets that our students use, based on research from all over campus, previous research that our professors have done, all kinds of, readily available data sets as well. So we are consistently ranked, one of the top 10 statistics departments in the nation for both our undergraduate and graduate programs. We have we are number one right now, I think, for the doctoral program. I think number 10 right now for the undergrad. We were number one a couple of years ago. We're going back to it. To tell you a little bit about our undergrad program, there are a lot of things that I think are really important to kind of just touch on very briefly. One is kind of like the foundational theory that's such an important part of what we do. We have pretty much an entire academic year geared towards helping students understand, probability theory, statistical inference, different modeling, all kinds of those things. But we also start with things like analyzing data within like the first week of the first year for students. I think we have a Tuesday, Thursday class for our intro course 36200, Reasoning with Data. By Thursday, students are already analyzing data without even having programming experience. We have a heavy focus on methods, choosing the right way, or maybe the best way to, get the answer from the data that you have. And we have a focus on, what we would call like hands-on or real world problems. We are regularly working with external partners to do all sorts of things, whether it's capstones or, research or you know, a ton of other things too. We do have active capstone programs. We have courses related to statistical research. We have sports analytics capstone. So we do have an industry research or corporate capstone available as well. So for graduation, or for our graduate outcomes, roughly 2/3 of our students go directly into industry. Whereas I'd say roughly 20 to 25%, depending on the year, do attend grad school instead. You can see some of the areas here that our students do decide to get involved with. So I know that we have a lot of different majors, but the most popular, of course, is our statistics and machine learning major. So I just wanted to talk very briefly about that. I'd say the cornerstone of the course, or kind of the foundation of the course, combines some mathematics, computer science programming skills, and of course some statistical methods and theory and things like that. We focus on real world problems in our courses. A lot of the courses that we have, the data sets there they're not textbook. So there's going to be a lot of, things like data cleaning and things like that, that maybe some other programs or departments don't even touch, maybe until, subsequent years. Our students are doing that from the very beginning. You'll also see, in our StatML coursework, that students are taking, kind of graduate level machine learning courses, normally by sophomore or junior year. So our students are walking away with, a significant skill set before they even reach senior year. A lot of our students are, ending up in really kind of interesting and unique internship opportunities that might typically be for graduate level students. So just wanted to kind of stress that. I do just want to spend a minute talking about our master's and PhD programs. We offer two master's programs in the department. The one that's a little bit more interdisciplinary, and I'd say a little bit more wide range, is our master's in statistical practice. There's an emphasis on kind of developing professional skills, statistical computing, and of course, data analysis. There's a big experiential learning component to this. There's a spring capstone where we work with real industry partners to solve real problems. Roughly about 80% of those students do go directly into industry. We also have a master's in computational finance. Now, this is a much more focused program. There is a New York City campus. It is very specialized. Students who consider this are typically considering working Wall Street or something along those lines. Here's some information there. Our PhD program, I'd say one of the things that's unusual about our program is that we have four areas of focus. We have methods, theory, application, and computing. We are constantly overhauling this to be a cutting-edge program. We are combining statistics, machine learning theory, and methodology, again, to solve real problems. All of our programs are highly interdisciplinary. We have a long history of working across different departments, as well as with working with various external partners. I'd say about 89% of our PhD graduates do get hired pretty much immediately. And we also have several joint PhD programs as well. There's more information here, and we'll make sure that the slides are available to you. Just in the interest of time, I'm going to move on. So a couple of ways to connect with the department. I'd say, any kind of industry research projects would make a great opportunity for our capstones, especially with our undergraduate students. We do offer a considerable amount of executive education opportunities as well, to help train or retrain maybe data scientists or machine learning professionals. We've worked with various companies related to finance, the automotive industry, life sciences, healthcare, and we try to help teach people how to think about data or how to use data to solve problems. We also have some classroom presentation opportunities as well. If you'd like to connect with our students in a more kind of like informal way, or even if you would like to just, you know, kind of pop in during kind of a lecture. We have a lot of, you know, different opportunities for the undergraduate and master's in statistical practice programs. You know, our students have worked in, you know, a large, you know, kind of, you know, there's a lot of different things that our students have done semester to semester. We have a couple of recent examples. Some of these are due to COVID, of course. You know, we've worked with COVID tracking. We've worked with understanding supply chains. You know, again, I'm not going to get into everything here. We'll make sure that this information is available to anyone that wants it. And of course, you know, a little bit more about our executive education. And, you know, we do have a considerable amount of, you know, outreach as well. We do host the Women in Data Science Conference, which is a, you know, definitely something, a source of departmental pride. We have students from, you know, and professionals from all over the country that come and participate or to give talks. We have our CMU Sports Analytics program. We have a yearly kind of annual conference. We also have a summer program as well that's related to data analytics. So if that's and oh, I'm sorry, this summer we also have a healthcare component to our summer research projects as well. So our students are getting involved, you know, in every industry. Just a couple of things here. I, of course, can be a contact for you. My email is there below. I'll also make sure to put it in the chat. The Director of Undergraduate Studies, Professor Peter Freeman, was unable to be here today. If you're interested in our MSP or PhD program, those contacts will be there as well. And of course, our executive education you know, specialists as well. I think that's it for me. Thank you so much for your time, everybody.
So we do have just one question so far in the chat. If any of you have questions, feel free to write them in the chat while we're addressing this one. But if you want to unmute, you can also just do that and ask your question directly. That's fine. The one question that was put in there, I think has already sort of been answered, but if anyone wants to add to it, do we have an opportunity to be part of Capstones if interested? So is there anything specific that any of you would like to suggest to employers if they are interested in being involved in a Capstone?
Rebecca has her hand.
Hello, everyone. And I just wanted to say hello and a big thank you to Glenn for representing our department. I had a conflict and I was really happy that Glenn stepped in and did such a wonderful job of telling you about everything we're doing in statistics and data science. So just briefly on the Capstones, with respect to us, each of the colleges at Carnegie Mellon have a director or an associate director that's associated with advancement or corporate relations. For example, in Dietrich, it's the director of corporate and government relations, Adam Cosgrove. And those are really good contacts to start getting connected to different departments in the college if you're interested in Capstones. If you're interested in a specific department, you can just reach out to the program directors. We have those conversations about Capstones all year round. We're always looking for partners in statistics and data science. In particular, we partner every single semester and during the summer with a wide variety of external partners, startups, Fortune 100s, government organizations, social service organizations, you know, you name it, we partner with them. So do please feel free to reach out.
Question. As I said, our speakers were kind enough to say that they can stay till 4:30. So if you have a question, feel free to either put it in the chat or unmute and ask it. Okay. Amory, I'll just jump in with that one. Okay. Do you, This one was sent to me. Do you see graduates that specifically come back to brush up on their skills or who need updated certifications through their job? Do you have programs that will work with potential students on this?
I can take that if you want. Yes, oftentimes we have a variety of students who come back to do executive education programs. The different colleges all have programs. They have ones in statistics and data science at Dietrich. They have ones at Tepper, and they have, we have a variety at the Heinz College. There are specialized programs which are open enrollment programs for specific disciplines around different career trajectories, like our C Digital O program between Heinz and Tepper, and Rebecca teaches in that one.
It's a good one. Well, you guys should take that one. That's a good one.
appreciate it. We have closed enrollment ones, like the one that I mentioned with Roche. I think Tepper has one with Moderna. And a variety of other folks. So there's mechanisms around capturing this, but one of the things that's, I think, is really unique around CMU is combining various different skill sets, departments, and expertise across the campus, not just within sort of a siloed specific school, if you will.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Okay, so here's one in the chat. I'll just read it. There seems to be an ongoing battle in market between the need for specialization versus the need for full stack knowledge. How are your CM programs approaching this conundrum?
I can speak a little bit for what we tend to do with our StatDS programs. So we kind of offer opportunities in both, right? So you'll have deep dive methodological courses that allow a very wide range of methodological courses that and concentrations that are available for the degrees to allow students to pick a specialization that may work really well for them if they're looking for kind of a targeted job market search. And I know that the Mellon College of Science and Heinz offer kind of similar type things, like ways to do kind of deep dives. But then you also see like experiential learning opportunities, capstone opportunities, where there's a lot of work on synthesizing a lot of the different skills that people have gained either at the undergraduate, master's, or even PhD levels. And that gets that full, even if the person graduating isn't a deep dive on full stack knowledge, they will have participated in projects and opportunities that cover that full stack knowledge. And so then students can do a little bit of picking and choosing, but at least on our side of the fence, they will see both kinds of things. And so they'll be able to then kind of pick what's more their, I guess their cup of tea, so to speak. But Amanda, I'm sure there's something similar over in MCS and bio, yeah?
Yeah, absolutely. Within our undergraduate degree program, we offer the option to specialize in various fields within biology that a lot of students will take advantage of to kind of increase the amount of bioinformatics work that they incorporate as part of their electives for the degree. And a lot of students will take on an additional major in statistics and machine learning or a minor in computer science to kind of further develop some of those skill sets that they're looking for to apply to the type of problems that they're interested in working on.
Thank you both. Does anyone else have a question? Well, if nobody else has a question, I think we'll wrap up. You have all the contact information for our wonderful presenters today. And I just want to thank all of our presenters, and thank you, the employers, for being here. Some of you have been to multiple sessions, and we really appreciate you coming. Take care, everyone.
Thank you. Bye.